You guys ready for the word of the Lord today? All right. Get your Bibles out. Get them in hand. Get your phones, your tablets, whatever you're taking notes on, all that good stuff. And let's prepare our hearts to receive today. Come on, let's pray together. Put your hearts on the Lord. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're so grateful today as we come into your house for your presence. God, what a great and mighty move of the Holy Spirit we've already seen. And Lord, we thank you for that. And it's not something that we did, that's something that you did. And so, Father, we give you praise and thanks for what you're going to do in our hearts and our lives today. God, today we recognize and we realize it's not a man or a woman, not the young or the old, not the black, the white, the brown, or any other color we could imagine. We've come to hear from you. Holy Spirit, you are the teacher of the church. Be welcome in this place. Be our teacher. Be our guide. Give us your vision, your wisdom, your instruction, your direction, even the correction we need for our lives. Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, also, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. We'd also ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are both preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. They're our brothers and sisters, God, and at no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So God, today we would ask that you bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals, Calvary Chapel, and the Assemblies of God, the four square denominations, Victory and Crossroads, and all the great churches that are out there. Lord, we pray for our Adventist brothers and sisters and Catholic brothers and sisters. Lord, if they're preaching your gospel truth, lifting up your name, God, we would bless them as you would bless us. God, also, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world, Lord. We pray for them as though we were chained with them, as it says in your word, God. We would ask that you encourage them, strengthen them, heal them, God. Bless them, deliver them, guide them, Lord. May they never give up, and may they never renounce your name. But, Lord, may they endure to the end, to the glory of God. And, Lord, we give you praise. In Jesus' mighty name, everybody in agreement said? Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. Today, get your Bibles out and go with me to Hebrews, the 12th chapter. We're continuing a little two-part series in Hebrews, the 12th chapter, and this series is called Bitter or Blessed. Hebrews, the 12th chapter, verse number 14 through verse number 17, last time we were together. I'm going to refresh some of your thinking. For those of you that are just joining us today for the very first time, don't worry, this message will stand on its own. But I would encourage you, get a hold of last time's message, because it's very important to go where we're going. If you're going to get a hold of what we're doing today, you can't forget about what we did last week, all right? And we'll talk about that a little bit as we go throughout. Hebrews, the 12th chapter, starting in verse number 14. I'm going to read through verse number 17 as we go. I'll remind you and refresh some of the things that we said last time we were together. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14 says, "Pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord." Now, remember we said this, that it's as if the apostle, whoever's writing the book of Hebrews, I believe it's probably the apostle Paul. Many other people think it's someone else, but it doesn't matter. It's really the Holy Spirit speaking to us. And so here, as the writer of Hebrews is writing to us, he says these words. He says, "Pursue peace with all people." These are instructions for our life, things that the Holy Spirit wants for us to do. And it's almost as if while he's writing, his memory is jogged, or his mind just comes alive, and he realizes, you know, you can pursue peace with all people, but without holiness, it's not going to do you any good. It's not going to work. You need the holiness of God in order to pursue peace with all people. Look at what he says, "without which no one will see the Lord." Now, we talked about that last time we were together. We talked about a holy life. And as it goes on in verse number 13, in verse number 15, it says, "looking carefully, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God. Lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled." Verse 16, "lest there be any fornicator or profane person like Esau, who for one morsel of food sold his birthright." Verse 17, "for you know that afterward, when he wanted to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place for repentance, though he sought it diligently with tears." Now, you remember we talked about Esau, and we talked about how Esau had sold himself for his own pleasures. And in doing so, he became that fornicator, that ungodly, profane person in the eyes of God. That's why Jacob I love, but Esau I hated, because Esau sold his birthright for a mess of pottage. You remember that? For just a bowl of lentil soup. Who does that? And in this sense, here he is, and he sells his birthright, and with his birthright, he loses his blessing. And in the same way, we need to live a holy life, because we sell out ourselves for our own pleasures, look at temporary things rather than eternal things, we will end up losing the blessings of God that each and every one of us want in our lives. Now, you remember in verse 15, it said that we are to be looking out, that we are to look carefully. And it says we are the people who look after it. Remember, we said that word looking literally means to be the bishop or the overseer of our own souls. Just like a bishop in a church looks out after the affairs of the church, that we are the overseer, we are the bishop of our own soul. See, we are to look after our own heart. Everything starts in the heart. We watch after the activities, pursuits, intents, and direction of our hearts. And that's why peace is to be sought, but not at the expense of our holiness. We're to watch where our heart is going and correct any wrong direction. In other words, as we're pursuing peace, we can see that we might want to compromise in some ungodly areas in order to have peace, when God has not called us to compromise on our holiness. God wants us to maintain our holiness and not give up, not slack on that, but he also wants us to pursue that peace. Remember, we talked about bitterness, and that bitter root is turning from God. That is, we reject God, as we reject his will and his way in our life, that day, that there will be a bitter root planted in our heart that will produce bitter and poisonous fruit. And that poisonous, I mean, eventually that's going to kill us, right? And so we need to watch out what's going on in our hearts. We need to stay holy. We need to stay pure. Now, the bitterness is not only turning from God, but it's also the blame, the piercing, and the shredding poison that tears us apart from others. It all starts in the heart. See, in our relationships, if we're going to pursue peace with all men, we need to make sure that we are holy before the Lord, but then as well, we need to make sure that there's no bitterness towards others. In 2002, the Haman fire in Colorado was started by a woman who burnt a letter from her estranged husband. The fire grew to be the biggest wildfire in Colorado's history. In 1 month, more than 130,000 acres burned, destroying 600 structures and taking 6 lives. All from the embers of one woman's bitterness. See, we need to be careful about what's going on in our hearts towards others. Because even though we might think that we're an island, we might think that what goes on inside of us doesn't affect other people. Well, as long as I keep a tight lip, maybe if I just don't get around anybody, if I just stay away, maybe that won't affect anybody. And yet, just like the embers of this woman's letter that she burned there in the forest, they're now, in the same way, those things that go on inside of our hearts, they don't stay just with us. No man is an island unto himself. We all affect other people. In fact, I heard a statistic one time that the most introverted person will affect 10,000 other people in their lifetime. That's pretty amazing, you guys. And yet we think that, oh, you know what, it doesn't matter. I'm just going to harbor this. I'm just going to hold on to this. It's not a big deal. I'll just stay away, and I just won't say anything. And yet that bitterness eventually will produce bitter and poisonous fruit, and eventually it will kill us. See, we are not in control of the actions of others. Oh, we need to understand that, don't we? We are not in control of the actions and the activities of others. Don't you wish you could control other people? I sure do. My goodness, I'd make people, you know, go do stuff and stop messing around and all that kind of stuff. I'd make them be nice. You know, that would be good, right? I'd make them smile. It'd be a wonderful place if I was in control of everything. And yet, we're not, right? God is in control of everything. And yet, even God gives us free will choice. All of us are free will agents. And so here God is saying, you cannot control the actions and the activities of others, but you can watch your own heart. You can control you. And you need to watch what's going on in your heart. And because of that, you need to pursue peace. See, we can choose to be bitter and let it grow, or we can choose holiness and let it go. That's a fun little rhyme, isn't it? We can choose bitterness and let it grow, or we can choose holiness and let it go. Let me show this to you in the Word of God. Turn with me. You're there in Hebrews chapter 12. Turn a couple pages over to James chapter 3. If you just turn back towards the back of your Bible, a couple pages over, James chapter number 3. James starts talking about the power of the tongue in the beginning of the chapter, right? And then as he goes on, he says, hey, can bitter water and sweet water produce from the same spring? Very interesting that he starts to use those terms. Bitter and sweet, can they come out of the same spring? In other words, your heart is the source of all the issues of your life. And if there's bitterness in your heart, only bitterness is going to come out. If there's sweetness in your heart, only sweetness can come out. And then in verse number 13, he comes along in James, the third chapter, verse number 13, he says this, who is wise and understanding among you? Now, we all would say, I want to be wise, right? I want to be understanding. I want to be that guy. I want to be that girl. I want to be the one who's wise and understanding, who people look to find out about the things of God, and who looks up to and can be followed in that sense. And look at what it says. Let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. Now, meekness is not weakness, all right? Sometimes we think about meekness. Jesus was meek, and, you know, oftentimes we think about the old carols at Christmas time. Jesus was meek and mild, right? It's a shame that that's the only thing that rhymes with child, because Jesus was meek, yes, but he was not mild in any sense. He was extra strength, right? He was the hot salsa. He was not that mild salsa. Jesus was full force. Jesus would be in people's faces, braiding a cord of whips to drive him out of the temple. He was anything but mild, right? That's our Jesus. This is the strong man of God. This is God in the flesh. He is the maximum strength. And yet, here we think of meekness as weakness. Meekness is not weakness. Meekness is submission to the control of the Holy Spirit and His wisdom in our lives. I think of it like this. I used to change oil at a Walmart Tire and Lube Express Center. Yes, your pastor was a grease monkey, all right? Down in the pit, getting all oily and all that kind of stuff. And during that time, we got to drive a lot of cars. And during that time, I got to drive 12-cylinder Corvettes. And I got to drive the old Camaros, 67 Camaro, right? And all that kind of stuff. And so there were times where I would get in a car, and even though I could have just tapped that little gas pedal and peeled some rubber and burnt out and went 60 miles an hour in the parking lot, I never did. Why? Because that's not my car. Hello. And I didn't want the owners going, "What are you doing with my car, dude? You're fired, man. I'm going to go talk to your manager." So what did I do? I drove it very carefully and very gently around. I mean, every now and then I tapped the gas a little bit just to see what it would do. And so, but then I would park it very gently and very kindly. See, meekness is like that car. Even though it has the ability to do more, meekness says, "I'm not going to." Even though I could open it up on the highway, I'm still going to go the speed limit. Why? Because that is the wisdom that's applied to my life. That's true meekness. And that's what Jesus could have called on legions of angels. Jesus could have wiped everyone out that opposed him. And yet he submitted himself and laid down his life for each and every one of us. That is meekness. So when it says, "Let him show by his conduct how you act in life, that his works are done in the meekness, in the humble submission to the word of God of wisdom." Now the next verse comes along and says this in verse 14, "But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth." See, once again, we see that this thing starts in the heart, right? So if you have bitter envy in your heart, don't boast and lie against the truth. In other words, "I'm fine. It's okay. No, nothing's wrong. Nothing. No, don't worry about me. It's fine." Yeah, we've all had those experiences, right? We've been on both the receiving and the giving end of that. "Oh, no, I'm good. It's okay." What are we doing? You're lying. Liar. See, and we get caught in the trap of the devil because the devil is the father of lies. Is that right? And the devil boasted and he was proud, and that pride is what ultimately was his downfall. "I will exalt myself. I will." See, that bitterness goes far beyond just our relationship with others. It will poison the well, guys. Goes on and it says this: wisdom, verse 15, does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. Maybe you never thought about bitterness in your heart as being something that was birthed by Satan. We would all hate to be a pawn of the devil, right? We would all say, "No, there's no way that I'm going to play into the devil's schemes. There's no way I'm going to allow the devil to move in my life." And yet, when we allow bitterness in, and when we submit ourselves to that bitterness, and we boast and we lie against the truth, what happens is that's not wisdom from above. That is earthly. That is sensual. It's based on our five senses, what I can taste, what I can touch, what I can see, what I can smell, and what I can hear. And it's demonic. It is controlled literally by Satan himself. And therefore, we need to watch what goes on in our hearts, because we can literally, as Christians, allow ourselves to be controlled by the devil and his ways rather than God and his ways. Are you listening today? Verse 16, "For where envy and self-seeking exist," notice last time he said bitter envy, right? This time he says, we know it's bitter. "So when envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there." Whoa! Every evil thing. That's pretty potent words from the prophet, from the word of God, isn't it? Here in James. And yet, this is what the word says, verse 17, "But the wisdom that is from above is first pure." Notice it's first pure, right? Think about this for a second, okay? Here's Jesus on the Mount of Beatitudes, right? He's speaking to the people, and he's giving the Beatitudes. He's talking to the people. And there he is, and he opens his mouth, and the wisdom starts to pour out. And he starts saying, "Blessed are those," right? And he starts giving us some things, the poor in spirit, right? And then he says, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." Do you know what the very next blessing that he speaks is? "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God." See, first pure, then peaceable. Let's see if it still applies in the book of James. The book of James, this wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable. Wow. See, pursue peace with all men and holiness. Right? He's saying make sure that holiness is there, because out of that holiness will flow the peace with others. Gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruit. See, wherever there's fruits, there's also a root, right? And it starts in your heart, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now, we know what hypocrisy is, right? You're a hypocrite. We've all said that. We've all been that at times, right? And so we understand that's when somebody says something one way and they have a value and yet they don't live up to that. You know, in the Greek times, the Greek word for hypocrisy or hypocrite literally was referring to an actor in a play. Somebody who dressed up a certain way, somebody who looked like something, somebody who acted like something, and yet was something totally different. We need to be careful as Christians that we're not dressing the part that Sunday comes along and, oh, bless the Lord, oh, my soul, oh, hey, brother, hey, sister, hallelujah, oh, glory to God, are you sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, are you doing good, God is good all the time, God is good, right? And we can say all the Christianese terms and slangs and all that kind of stuff, peace be on you, brother, and all that kind of stuff, and yet then we go home and we live like the devil. You know what that is? That's hypocrisy. You're an actor in a play. You are playing a part, and listen, you're not fooling God. You might be able to fool every person on the earth, but when you stand before the judgment seat, God is the one who sees right through the facade. God can see right through the mask. God knows what's behind the makeup, and God knows what is going on in your heart. And we'll give an account to God, and therefore it's very important that we purify ourselves, that we stay holy, and that it's not just an act, but that we're submitted to the wisdom of God. Now look at what it says in verse 18. Now the fruit, once again, wherever there's a fruit, there's also a root, and it starts in the heart. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. So today, I just want to give you a couple of things, okay? A couple of easy-to-remember, simple things about uprooting bitterness with others. Now we talked about staying away from getting a bitter root of unholiness in our heart last time. Now we're talking about bitterness with others, okay? Now, how many of you know that simple and easy to remember does not necessarily mean easy to do? Okay, so I'm going to tell you some things today that you're going to go, that's so simple, that's so easy to remember, why can't I do it, all right? Because the simplest things often are the hardest things for us to do. And I'm going to show this to you right now on the first one, and that is forgive. Forgive. Very simple. Simple word. We all know it. And yet we don't always do it, right? But Pastor Dan, you don't know what they did to me. No, I don't. But God does. Pastor Dan, you don't know the pain that I endured. No, I don't. But God does. You don't know how much they hurt me. No, I don't. But God does. Pastor, I can't forgive. I've tried to forgive. I want to, but I just don't know how to do it. Well, today I'm going to show you simply how to forgive. Ephesians chapter 4, turn there with me. The book of Ephesians chapter number 4, the Apostle Paul is writing to the church at Ephesus. And he's talking to them about their lives, giving them some instructions, telling them how they ought to live life according to the word of God. Because of who Jesus is and because of what he's done, now he's giving them practical things for living. There at the end of Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 31 and verse number 32, right at the end, so if you find chapter 5, just back up a couple verses. He says this in verse 31, let all bitterness, oh, there's that word right away. Let, everybody say let. Yes. When you see let, it's a choice, right? You could let this happen. You could let it go. You could let it stay. It's your call. It's your choice. So he says, let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. See, we have a choice to either hold on to this stuff or to let it go. Now listen, don't worry, I'm not going to sing the Frozen song to you today, okay? That'll be another message for another time. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Verse 32, and be kind to one another. Tender-hearted, remember, it all starts in the heart. And so as you start to approach that person that just makes you angry, that person that hurt you, that person that as you approach them, you turn into that little kid once again, that person that you could not forgive, allow your heart to be open. You say, if I open my heart, I'll be hurt again. Yeah, you might be. That's okay. Because remember, Jesus forgave us while we were still sinners, right? Jesus opened his heart to us knowing that we would hurt him again. And so therefore, we ought to do the same thing with one another. Look at the rest of the verse. Forgiving one another. I can't do that. I've tried that. I've gone to prayer and I said, Lord, I forgive him. And then when I saw him again, I was right back in the same place. How do I forgive? Here's how. Look at the rest of the verse. Even as God in Christ forgave you. That means in the same manner as God in Christ forgave us, that we can in Christ forgive someone else. In other words, it's not about your ability to forgive. You cannot forgive. I understand completely because the pain is too great. The hurt is too big. It's just too much. They've gone too far. They've done it again and again and again. And if you hurt me once, shame on you. You hurt me twice, shame on me, right? And we shut up our hearts and we say, I can't do this. I can't forgive. It's just going to hurt me all over again. And I don't want to be unwise. Now listen, I'm not saying throw out wisdom, but what I am saying is by the power of the Holy Spirit, you can forgive. Doesn't make you a doormat. Doesn't give you permission for them to hurt you again, all right, even though that may happen. But what it does is it allows the forgiveness of God to flow through you to others. Now listen to this. It also doesn't condone their actions when you forgive. Some of you guys need to hear this. Because you think that if you release the offense and you forgive them, that says it's okay what they did to me. It's not okay what they did to you. Okay? You are not condoning them, but also in forgiving them, you're not condemning them. See, Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more, right? See, we should operate in the forgiveness of God in Christ Jesus. That means when you take that forgiveness issue and you say, God, I can't forgive, but I am going to put this offense under the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, you forgave me. God, I was messed up. I was tore up from the floor up. God, I had no hope. God, I was just a sinner. I was out scraping by. I was eating the pig slop in the pig pen. And yet when I came to myself, God, I was unworthy. And when I started walking towards you, you saw me afar off and you started running to me. And God, how much I offended you. God, I wasn't worthy to be your son or your daughter, but God, you welcomed me in. God, I only wanted to be a slave. I only wanted to be a servant, but God, you put your ring on my finger. You put your robe on my back. You put your shoes on my feet. And God, if you can do that to me, then Lord, I release them in the power of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I forgive them as you forgave me. See, that's how you do it. We must follow peace. We must follow peace. We must forgive. We must follow peace, even with those who would be instruments of our suffering. We must follow peace, even with those who would be instruments of our suffering. Corrie ten Boom, many of you guys know who Corrie ten Boom is, great woman of God. She's a woman whose family helped Jews survive in Holland and who was eventually sent to a Nazi concentration camp. And she lived to tell the story. This is Corrie up on the overheads behind me. Great lady. She's gone to be with the Lord. She's just a wonderful woman of God. Wrote many books. Deeply impacted my life and the lives of many others. This is her house, her family's house in Holland there. And you can see they were clockmakers and watch repair. They had a watch repair shop. In that shop, they were very friendly with the neighborhood, very friendly with the people around them. And this family helped, I think, roughly 600 Jews survive during the Nazi invasion there in Holland. Over here, you can see how they did it. Okay, on this side, you see how there's a hole in the wall revealing what's behind that. That hole wasn't always there. That was covered up there with the wallpaper and that sort of thing. But that cabinet would open up, and you see on the bottom how it's the same color as the wall there. What they would do is they had a false backing on that, and they would stack that with towels or whatever. But when they would have the Jews come over, they would come in, and then they would hide them in that place. They would open that up, pull out the bottom there, they would crawl through, and then they could live back there, and they would have ration cards, and she had some friends who gave out the ration cards, and so she was able to get hundreds of rations that she was able to feed the Jews that stayed in their house, and they were able to transport them to other places and help them get out of the area. And so this is a great woman of God. Now, she and her family got caught, and her sister actually died in the concentration camp. She writes in her book, The Hiding Place. After all of this takes place, and she's out, and she starts ministering, she says, it was in a church service in Munich that I saw him, the former SS man who stood guard at the shower room door in the processing center at Ravensbrück. He was the first of our actual jailers that I had seen since that time, and suddenly it was all there, the room full of mocking men, the heaps of clothing, Betsy's pain-blanched face. He came up to me as the church was emptying, beaming and bowing. How grateful I am for your message, Fraulein, he said. To think that, as you say, he has washed my sins away. His hand was thrust out to shake mine, and I, who had preached so often that people need to forgive, kept my hand at my side. Even as the angry, vengeful thoughts boiled through me, I saw the sin of them. Jesus Christ had died for this man. Was I going to ask for more? Lord Jesus, I prayed, forgive me and help me to forgive him. I tried to smile, struggled to raise my hand, but I could not. I felt nothing, not the slightest spark of warmth or charity. And so again, I breathed a silent prayer. Jesus, I cannot forgive them. Give me your forgiveness. As I took his hand, the most incredible thing happened. From my shoulder, along my arm, and through my hand, a current seemed to pass from me to him. While into my heart sprang a love for this stranger that almost overwhelmed me. And so I discovered that it is not on our forgiveness any more than on our goodness that the world's healing hinges, but on his. When he tells us to love our enemies, he gives along with the command the love itself. You cannot forgive in your own strength, but as you allow the love of the Lord Jesus Christ and the forgiveness of God to go through your heart, it will extend to others. Can somebody in this place say amen today? Uprooting bitterness with others. First thing is this, forgive. Second thing is this, do your part. Do your part. You can't do other people's parts. You can't make them receive the forgiveness. How many of you ever went to somebody, you said, okay, that's it. I'm done with this. I'm breaking down the walls. I'm ending the war. You go to that person and you humble yourself. You say, I am so sorry for what I've done. I have hurt you. I need your forgiveness. I apologize. And you know what? Before you even say anything, I release you and I'm going to forgive you. And they sat there with stink face and they just stared you down and did nothing. Anybody that happened to them other than Pastor Dan, right? Okay, all of us have had that happen at one time or another, right? Where you say, wait a second, that's not how it's supposed to go. God, I did what you said. I should be blessed. They should be happy. They should be wanting to be my best friend again. They should be wanting to forgive too. They didn't even say they're sorry, God. They felt justified. It was almost as if when I apologized, they felt vindicated. What's up with that, God? And yet God says, you just do your part. Don't worry about their part. I'll take care of them. You do your part, and I'll take care of you. Hello. See, we need to seek peace and make peace with the wisdom of God and with the power of the Holy Spirit. And then we leave the results up to God, right? Because we can't control other people, even though we want to. I say, I forgive you. You say, I forgive you too. I say, I love you. You say, I love you too. But things don't always go our way. In other words, you won't always have peace. You won't always have a positive result. You say, Pastor, but isn't that contrary to the word of God? Yes, because not everyone lives according to the word of God. You just do your part and you leave the results up to God. Amen? The Apostle Paul wrote this in Romans, the 12th chapter. Turn there with me. Romans, the 12th chapter. Once again, here the Apostle is giving general, different, various insights and instructions for life, giving them things to live by. And here in Romans chapter number 12, verse number 18 comes along, and he says this words. He says, if, everybody say if. Biggest little word in the Bible, remember, everything hinges on this, right? It's like the teeter-totter, this is the center. If, it could be or it could not be. But he says, if it is possible. In other words, sometimes it's possible, but sometimes it's not possible. If it is possible, as much as depends on you. Ooh. That means you do as much as you can, as often as you can, in every way that you can. If it is possible, as much as depends on you, live peaceably with all men. That means you just do your part. You just keep your heart clean. You just forgive. Even if you have to forgive up to 7 times a day or 7 times 77 times a day, Jesus said, right? And there are times where somebody's getting on your nerves and you just, I forgive them. Lord, I put them under the blood, right? And then you go over here and then all of a sudden, oh God, they just did it again. I forgive them. I put them under the blood. And then it goes on a little bit further and you start to clench your fist. You say, no, I forgive them and I put them under the blood. Even if you have to do that every minute of every day, Jesus said, you better, because your forgiveness hinges on your forgiving others. So therefore, oh God, I don't want to be not forgiven. So God, I'm going to forgive them, Lord. I release them as much as depends on you. You do your part, God does his part, and you are not responsible for the actions of others. Hello. You just release them into the hands of God. God, get them. Uprooting bitterness with others. Forgive. Do your part. Last one is this. Make a plan. Make a plan. Plan it out. Plan it beforehand. I'm going to go. I'm going to buy a Snickers bar. I'm going to leave it on their desk with a little note that says, I forgive you and I love you. Let's end the war, right? Because you're doing unto others as you would have them do to you, and you like Snickers, so you say, I want a Snicker bar. I don't want none of that Mars bars or none of that kind of stuff. I want a Snickers, and so I'm going to satisfy somebody right now. I'm going to bless somebody. And so you leave that, not just the little snack size, right? They call those fun size. That ain't no fun. You king size, right? The two bars in one packet. That's what I'm talking about, double-fisted, right? And so therefore, I'm going to bless somebody with that, and I'm going to leave that on their desk, and therefore, I'm going to say, I'm going to do my body. See, you plan it out. Think about it. When you get in the car today, some of you husbands and wives have been at odds with one another and you need to forgive. Right now, you need to start formulating a plan. I'm going to humble myself. I'm going to say the words and they're going to actually come out of my mouth this time. I am sorry. Gentlemen, let's practice it. Ready? I am sorry. Okay? Those are three words that will change your marriage. How about this one? I was wrong. Let's try it, men. I was wrong. Okay? Plain and simple. Two more words. You ready? Okay, I know this is a lot, gentlemen. I know this is a lot. Forgive me. Ready? Forgive me. Just, that's the plan. I'm sorry. I was wrong. Forgive. Change your life right there. Be like a honeymoon all over again. Oh, I forgive you. There it goes, right? Do your part as much as depends on you. But see, if she sits there with stink face, gentlemen, don't point it out. See, I knew this was going to happen, right? Nah, stupid. Stupid man. Don't do it. Abort. 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 You, as much as depends on you. See, sometimes it takes a while to heat up the icy cold heart. See, you got to just love, and you got to consistently love. She's not looking for one time, right? She's heard that all before. This time, do it from the heart, and then show by the meekness of wisdom that your actions are done, right? According to what God says, stay consistent, all right? Stay after it, continue. And if you mess up again, because all of us will, right? I'm sorry, I was wrong. Forgive me. It's that simple. You continue to do that and you continue to grow and be patient with me. Help me to grow. Help me to see how I do this. Ladies, same thing applies to you. It's for all of us. Make a plan. Proverbs chapter 20 in the New Living Translation. This is some really loud laughs over there. I don't know what's going on, but somebody's getting free in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 20, the New Living Translation, deceit fills the hearts that are plotting evil. See, sometimes we plot evil, right? I'm just going to get them. They're going to get a piece of my mind. I'm going to tell them, and I'm going to not let it go. I'm going to speak the truth. No, speak the truth in love, all right? Oh, I'll speak it in love, right? I love them, but I'm going to tell them how it is. Right? Necks all going around, all that kind of stuff. We are in San Bernardino. Hello. Come on, somebody. Deceit fills the hearts that are plotting evil. But look at this. Joy fills hearts that are planning peace. See, it all starts in the heart. And as you start to plan peace, oh, I'm going to get them with some forgiveness. I'm going to get them with some love. I'm going to get them with an act of service. I'm going to get them with some words of affirmation. I'm going to get them with some time spent with them. I'm going to pour into them. Listen, I am going to repair the breach. Now, listen, it's not always going to work. You can't control the actions of others. But as you do, it doesn't matter. The joy of the Lord will fill your heart, because there you have now the love of God. And out of the love of God flows all the fruit of the Spirit, right? There is a root of the Spirit of God inside of you, and the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, right? Peace, long suffering. See, and it all starts to flow, and you will just be overflowing. See, we need to be our brother's keeper. Let me say that again. We need to be our brother's keeper. Listen, you better be repairing damages that are done in the house of God, because these are your brothers and your sisters. Now, that doesn't mean you need to be best friends and go over to each other's houses and eat all the time. But at least, at the very least, come to a godly understanding. Listen, I forgive you. I love you. And we're going to live our lives in Christian unity and brotherhood together. At least we can agree on the word of God together, right? So some of you guys after church need to cross the sanctuary and go talk to somebody over there and say, I'm sorry. I was wrong. Please forgive me. As much as depends on you. We need to be our brother's keeper, because if not, they may fall short. See, your actions, remember, no man is an island. Your actions affect other people. We watch ourselves, but we also watch out after the lives of others. Remember, in order to fulfill the law of the Lord, we need to love God first, and we need to love others second. And the book of Galatians says to bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. We need to be our brother's keeper. We need to watch out after others. We snatch people from the fire. If they're going the wrong way, snatch them out of the fire. Restore them in a spirit of gentleness, fearing lest you fall also. Wow. See, the root of bitterness will not only defile us, but it will defile others. If you allow bitterness in your heart, well, just let them go to hell, right? Just go on. If that's how you're going to be. But we see this with Cain and Abel. Here was bitterness in his heart. He rejected the ways of God, and God rejected his sacrifice, and that bitter root went on the inside of him, and it poisoned him. But it didn't stay with Cain. He ended up rising up and killing his brother. See, if we don't watch out, we will end up with bitter fruit that not only poisons us and our well, but it'll poison others, defile many. Our bitterness doesn't stay with us any more than our grace and our holiness stays with us. Ooh, come on, that's good. See, our bitterness doesn't just stay with us any more than our grace and our holiness stays with us. See, when you live a holy life, your holiness is sloppy. Did you know that? Your holiness is messy. Your holiness will bubble up out of your life, and it will start to get all over the people around you. It'll be like paint slopping. All of a sudden, people will be spotted with the goodness of God. It'll just be bubbling over. It'll be like perfume and fragrant oil that people that get around you, all of a sudden, they're going to smell like you. They're going to look like you. They're going to taste like you. All of a sudden, people are going to be filled with the joy of the Lord. Why? Because you are pursuing peace with all men. You're taking care of what you need to do. See, one stains, the other cleans. Bitterness stains, but holiness cleans. And that's what we need to do. We need to plan on having peace. Colossians chapter 3, let's end with this. You're there in Romans, turn back past Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, and then finally to Colossians chapter number 3, verse number 12 through verse number 15. Coming in for a landing here. Here we go. Therefore, Colossians chapter 3, verse 12, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on, everybody say put on. It's a choice. You know, this morning when you got dressed, you put on something, and you planned how your day was going to be. I'm going to go to church, so I'm going to put on something nice today, because God deserves my best. Amen? Some of you guys planned this way. You said, ooh, looks a little bit cold out there this morning. Looked a little chilly. I'm going to put on a jacket. But if it gets hot, I'm going to put on a lightweight jacket. That way I can take it off. Some of you guys said, I know so-and-so is going to be there today, and they're looking good, so I better be looking good too. See, you planned your day, right? Come on, single people, say amen. You know it's true. Don't lie. You're in church. See, you put on something. You planned what you were going to wear today. You planned to get dressed. You planned to eat breakfast. You planned, you know what, I've been eating eggs all week. I'm going to eat cereal today. You made a plan. There was a thought in your heart that started to something, and then it worked its way into your life. In the same way, plan for peace. Look at what he says. Put on. Everybody say put on once more. Put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering. Verse 13, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. Oh, there it is once again. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so also you must do. That's not an option, guys. Must is must. Must is not you should. Maybe it's a good idea. If you do, it's cool. If not, oh well. No, you must. You must do. This is a command of the Lord God Almighty to you and to me today. Verse 14, but above all these things, put on. Everybody say put on. Put on love, which is the bond of perfection, and let. Everybody say let. This is your choice. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which you are also called in one body, and be thankful. We need to be thankful that God forgave us. We need to be thankful that we have life and breath, and that we have an opportunity to live out our lives in the goodness of God. We need to be thankful that God is good to each and every one of us. What do we learn today? If we're going to uproot bitterness with others, we learn that we need to forgive. We need to do our part, and we need to make a plan. Plan it out to live at peace with all men. Can you guys say amen today? Is that good? Let's do this. Let's do this. Let's just take a moment, and everybody bow your heads, close your eyes, and I want you to just take a moment with God. What is God speaking to you today? What's God ministering to your heart? Maybe there's somebody you need to forgive right now. Just release them into the blood of Jesus. Ask God for his forgiveness to flow through you at this time. You can't forgive them on your own. You need the forgiveness of God. Maybe God's telling you to do your part. You can't be responsible for someone else, but you can be responsible for yourself. Do your part. Maybe God is speaking to you and he's saying, make a plan. If you don't know how to plan, ask the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will show you things to come. Help me plan it, Lord. Help me to see what I need to say when that person comes back into my life. What's God speaking to you? Would you just take a moment and write that down? If you have your notepad there, if you have your tablet or your phone, just write down what God spoke to you right now. See, there's accountability when you write it down. And I know that if I don't write stuff down, I'll forget it. Maybe you're the same way. So just write it down. If you're with your husband or wife, just whisper that in their ear right now. Maybe you need to say, I'm sorry. I was wrong. Please forgive me. Go ahead right now. Take that moment with your spouse. Whisper in their ear what God just spoke to you. Take that moment. Father, we just commit these things to you, Lord, those things which you've spoken. We thank you for your word, God, and we receive it with meekness. God, we will readily submit to the things that you've called us to. God, we thank you that Jesus is our Lord, that he's forgiven us. We love you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Everybody in agreement said, amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hallelujah.